So let us all surrender our life in the presence of God. And I hope all of you remember the main title of our message, and it is Restoration, the Need of Christian Church Today. And our text scripture was Ezra chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. Ezra chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. And today's message is the fourth part, the part number 4 of the same topic. And last two Sundays, we have been studying about the subject, title called The Areas Where the Restoration is Necessary in Our Christian Life. And the two areas we already discussed was the restoration from captivity, and also the second one was the restoration of the altar or the worship. Amen. And it was from Ezra chapter 3. It was from Ezra chapter 3. And we know that right after returning, the people of Israel returning back to Jerusalem from Babylonian captivity, they together started to build or rebuild the altar of God to offer the burnt offerings. Amen. So the first thing that they did was rebuilding the altar. Even before they rebuild the temple, which shows that worship must be the number one priority in our Christian lives. We have been discussing about that. You know, as soon as they reach back from Babylon to Jerusalem, they are trying to rebuild the altar of God. Amen. And then after that only, they are trying to rebuild the temple of Jerusalem. So that means worship must be the number one priority in our Christian life. And we discussed about that. Altar is the place of receiving, and altar is the place of surrender, and also altar is the place of giving. Amen. And let me continue the same subject now. And after that, we will think about the third point of our message as the time permits. And now let me ask you one question. The question is this. Who laid the foundation for animal sacrifice in the Bible? Who laid the foundation for animal sacrifice in the Bible? Or who did the animal sacrifice first in the Bible? Who did the animal sacrifice first in the Bible?
God the Father.
Lord the Father. Amen. So we will read Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. Yeah, Genesis chapter 3, verse 21. Yeah.
And the Lord God made for Adam and for his wife garments of skins and clothed for them.
Thank you, Jason, brother. You know, it was good, and the answer is correct. Here we read in this particular verse, Lord God made the garments of skin for Adam and Eve and his wife, and he clothed them with that garments. That means God himself laid the foundation for animal sacrifices by providing the garments of skin for Adam and Eve. And God took a sacrificial animal, probably a lamb, slew it before the eyes of Adam and Eve, and wrapped the skins about their naked bodies. When I speak about these things, you may have a question here it says garments of skin, okay? The garments of skin. And the question will be, it could be the skin of a tree, or it could be the skin of an animal. And how can we believe it was the skin of an animal? Okay, so this is the usual question that the people are asking. How can we say that the skin that God was making the garments out of, it was the skin of animal, or it was the skin of tree, or the skin of any other things? So we can prove that in two ways. Firstly, the Hebrew word which is used for garments of skin is anwarfresh. Anwarfresh is the Hebrew word which is used for the garments of skin. And the skin of it, that is the meaning of that word is the skin of an animal. And secondly, God was doing everything with an eternal and perfect purpose of salvation for the fallen man. So when God was doing something, God has a special purpose about the people, that no one should perish, but everyone should come and join to the Lord, and everyone should come to the presence of God back. Amen. So that was the eternal perfect purpose of, God when he was doing something. So because we read in book of Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22, Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22, we will read that verse. Elsa is reading today's, Bible verses. Yeah.
Indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins.
Very good. It says that there is no forgiveness of sin without shedding blood. There is no forgiveness of the sins without shedding the blood. And we read in Exodus and Leviticus and other books also about the sacrificing the animal for the remission of the sins. So we believe that God made garments of skin of an animal for Adam and Eve and his wife and clothed them, which indicates the sacrificial death of Christ on the cross of Calvary. So that's the reason I said, when God is the person who laid the foundation for the worship or for the altar, okay, that means making a sacrifice, the animal sacrifice. Okay, so that indicates the sacrificial death of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. And I believe personally, God gave them, verbal instructions about sacrifices and covering of the sins. But it is not recorded in the scripture. Okay, so you have to do in this way. It is not written how to do the worship or how to, offer the sacrifice. It is not, written in scripture in book of Genesis. But I personally believe that God have verbally said to them, this is what you have to do. Now, the second question is, who built the first altar for the sacrifice mentioned in the Bible? Who built the first altar for sacrifice mentioned in the Bible? Any answer? The first altar. I'll give the answer. It's in Genesis. Yes.
Abel.
Okay. So sometimes we used to say that, okay, it was Abel who built the altar. But there is no evidence in Bible that they were making an altar or something. They just brought the offering in the presence of God. Both of them, Abel and Cain, they brought the sacrifices or the offerings in the presence of God. But it is not written, it is not mentioned that they build an altar. But when you go to Genesis chapter 8, verse 20, there we read that Noah, after the flood,
Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar.
Okay, what is that? Noah, after the flood, built an altar to the Lord, but somebody said it is Cain and Abel, okay, built the first altar. But we know that it is sure that they offered the sacrifice, but it is not mentioned that they built an altar there. I'm saying that this just before the information. Again, we see the next person who built the altar and offered the animal sacrifices, that is Abraham, that we read in Genesis chapter 8, verse 20. So in Genesis chapter 8, verse 20, we read that Abraham was, building an altar to offer the animal sacrifice. And again, when we read the book of Exodus, we understand the people of Israel were in Egyptian captivity for 430 years. Amen. Especially when you read Exodus chapter 12, verse 40. Let us read that verse. Exodus chapter 12, verse 40. Yes, Elsa. So actually, we won't be reading all the verses today. We have many verses because of the lack of time. We'll be reading only a few of the verses from there. Okay. So now we will read Exodus chapter 12, verse 40.
The time that the people of Israel lived in Egypt was 430 years.
Okay, so it is clearly written that in this particular verse that the people of Israel were in Egyptian captivity for 430 years. Then again, When we read in Exodus chapter 19, on the way back from the Egyptian captivity at the Mount of Sinai, through Moses, God gave all the Ten Commandments and detailed laws and instructions about the worship and altar and many other things. So that is the right. That was the accurate time that when God was giving the laws and Ten Commandments and instructions about the worship and altar and all other things. That is written in Exodus chapter 19 verse 24. God said to Moses, "You shall make an altar of earth or mud for me." So that is the first one. Exodus chapter 19 verse 24, God said to Moses that you shall make an altar of earth or mud for me. When you go to Exodus chapter 27 verse 1, Exodus chapter 27 verse 1. Okay, we will read that verse. Yeah.
You shall make the altar of acacia wood, 5 cubits long, 5 cubits broad. The altar shall be square and its height shall be 3 cubits.
Okay, here we read that you shall make the altar of acacia wood. Okay, so another one. And later we understand a bronze altar was placed in the tabernacle of Moses. And again, when Solomon became king, a king, and he built a temple of the Lord in Jerusalem. And he created the elaborated altars of bronze and gold in Jerusalem. So this altar was destroyed by the Babylonians. And now we see the leaders from the people of Israel return back from Babylon, and they are trying to rebuild that temple and that altar in Ezra chapter 3. This is the history of that particular event which was happening there. Okay, so the altar was there and the temple was there, but the altar and the temple were destroyed by the enemies, especially by the Babylonian captives. Okay, so this is the reason that we are thinking about these points. Now they are trying to rebuild the altar and also the temple, after returning back from the captivity in Ezra chapter 3. And in chapter 3, verse 3, okay, we will read Ezra chapter 3, verse 3 now, then we will move on. Yeah, Ezra chapter 3, verse 3.
They set the altar in its place, for fear was on them because of the peoples of the lands. And they offered burnt offerings on it to the Lord, burnt offerings morning and evening.
What is that? We read the first thing Joshua, the high priest, did was resetting or rearranging the altar so he could offer sacrifices for the people. So the people were afraid of the strong nations around them. There were many nations around them. Okay, so they were the people of Israel. They were afraid of the strong nations around them, who resented the return of the Jews. And they wanted to be sure they were pleasing to the Lord. So the reason that they were doing the rebuilding of the altar was, they just wanted to make sure that they are pleasing God and they are offering the offerings to the Lord and they are worshiping God. That was the reason that they were trying to rebuild that altar. So first of all, they rebuild, the altar for the burnt offering. And the burnt offering, they had to bring the animal according to their capacity. Okay, so they were supposed to bring the animal for the offering. That you can see there in the screen. You know, when you read Leviticus chapter 1 verse 14, we understand they were bringing many animals. In different people. They were bringing different animals to offer in the presence of God. From different categories. According to their capacity. Okay, and we have to understand that it could be from the cattle. And it could be from the sheep or a goat. And if one cannot afford the lamb or cattle, he can bring at least a bird like a dove or a young pigeon. Okay, that's what we read in Leviticus chapter 1, verses 1 through 17. At least we will read only one verse, that is Leviticus chapter 1, verse 14. Leviticus chapter 1, verse 14. Yeah.
If his offering to the Lord is a burnt offering of birds, then he shall bring his offerings of turtle doves or pigeons.
Amen. So what is that? I know the majority of people know many things about all these Old Testament scriptures, but why I'm elaborately telling all these things, because I know there are still few people listening who does not have any idea or maybe little idea about all these things. Amen. So my focus is let them also know the importance of the Old Testament altar and also the worship in the New Testament, and also how much important is the Christian worship today. Christian worship today. So let me encourage you once again, the worship must be the number one priority of our Christian life. But let me remind you one more thing, that a worshiper must have a total submission and consecration as he approaches to the altar. That's what we read in Old Testament. When a person is approaching to the altar, that person should have a total submission and consecration and as he approaches to the altar. So he must respect the presence of God. And where there is a complete surrender, the altar becomes the place of receiving and blessing. Hallelujah. So when we come to the presence of God, when the people of Israel, they were coming to the, to the altar, they were having that submission. And they were, receiving many things from the Lord. And they were blessed by the, presence of God there. And most of the time, we need, the blessings from God. But how much we are submitted in the hands of God, I don't know. Most of the time we are asking the blessings from the Lord, asking the blessings from the Lord. We need the blessing, O Lord. Bless me, O Lord. Bless my family, O God. Bless my church, O God. And bless all these people, O God. And we are asking for the blessing. I don't know how much we are submitting in the hands of God. But remember one thing, how much we humble ourselves in his presence, that much we will be blessed and lifted up in all the realms of our life. Hallelujah. That's a true thing that, how much we are humbling ourselves in the presence of God, that much, we will be lifted up in the presence of God in all our realms. Hallelujah. So let us be sincere worshipers in the presence of God. Let us be the sincere worshipers and worshiping in truth and spirit. Hallelujah. Now, let us study about the third area where the restoration is necessary in our Christian life. The third area where the restoration is necessary in our Christian life is the restoration or rebuilding of the temple. Restoration or rebuilding of the temple, which we can see from Ezra chapters 3 and 4, and also chapter 6, verses 13 to 15. Okay, these are the verses that we can see, how those people were restoring or rebuilding of the temple. So the first one was, rebuilding or restoring the altar of God in Jerusalem. And second thing that they did was, restoring or rebuilding the temple of Jerusalem. So let us read, three verses from that particular point. This is the third point, okay? Now we will read Ezra chapter 3, verses 6, 12, and 13. Ezra chapter 3, verses 6, 12, and 13.
From the first day of the seventh month, they began to offer burnt offerings to the Lord, but the foundation of the temple of the Lord was not yet laid. But many of the priests and Levites and the heads of fathers' houses, old men who had seen the first house, wept with a loud voice when they saw the foundation of this house being laid, though many shouted aloud for joy, so that the people could not distinguish the sound of joyful shout from the sound of people's weeping. For the people shouted with great shout, and the sound was heard far away.
Amen. Hallelujah. So now, when you think about the restoration or rebuilding of the temple, chapter 3, verse 6 must be there in your mind. Okay. As we start to think about the rebuilding of the temple, we have to think about what happens, in chapter 3, verse 6. Amen. So it says that, but the foundation of the temple of the Lord had not been laid. The foundation of the temple of the Lord had been not laid till that time. So that means in chapter 3, we see the work didn't begin until the second month of the next year. That is what we read there. Amen. The work of rebuilding of the temple, they didn't begin until the second month of the next year. So they were waiting for that, which means they spent nearly 7 months gathering materials and preparing to build the temple. Amen. Remember one thing, they were spending more time. They were taking, almost 7 months to gather the materials, to build the temple. And they were preparing to build the temple. That means they need a preparation before building the temple. The preparation for building the temple. Hallelujah. So actually, we have to understand one thing. The temple is indicating the worship of a person also. You know, whenever we come for the worship, we need to have the preparation for worship. Simply we cannot worship God. We have to surrender our life first, and we have to submit ourselves with the mighty hand of God. Then only we can worship the Lord, because God knows whatever we speak and whatever we spoke, and God knows whatever we were thinking, and God knows whatever we're doing in the previous days or previous minutes. So whenever we come to the worship and come for the worship, we have to take time in the presence of God and think about what is my mistakes and what is my weakness and what is my faults and all those things. And we have to think about all those things, and we have to surrender our life in the presence of God. Then only we'll be able to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, here we understand that Joshua and Zerubbabel were in charge of the project. So assisted by the Levites, we understand there. Okay, Joshua and Zerubbabel were in charge of the project of the rebuilding of the temple. And the Levites also were assisting them. And you know, when you read Psalm number 11, verse 3, I'll say that, Psalm number 11, verse 3, it says that, David is asking, if the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? So the foundation is necessary thing in our Christian life. But before that, we have to prepare ourselves for the present. In the presence of God for the worship. Hallelujah. Without preparation, don't go for worship. Prepare yourself before worshiping. Spend a few minutes in the presence of God. Think about the glory of God. And think about what is my failure. Think about the area which is to be corrected. So after that only, we are supposed to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. That's why we understand, foundation is necessary thing in our Christian life and in our Christian worship. So if you feel the foundation is destroyed, let us lay the foundation and spend time to prepare for that and build the foundation first. Because without a strong foundation, the building cannot exist. Without a strong foundation, the building cannot exist. You know, we know that, very clearly, if the foundation is not, strong, then there is no existing of the building. So it is important to, make the foundation first. Make the strong foundation first, then we are trying to build upon that foundation the other parts of the, building. So it is very clear that the laying of such a foundation was not at all a matter of wasting time. You know, we have been thinking that, okay, they took almost 7 months to prepare themselves. They took 7 months to, arrange the materials. It was not a waste time. Every moment had been precious for them. Every moment had been precious for them. They did not waste their time, but with much hard work, the foundation stones were carefully laid in preparation for the completion of the temple in temple building. So we have to think about how much precious is every moment in our Christian life and Christian worship. Hallelujah. They were not wasting their time, but they were working hard and to lay the foundation, I mean, a stone, and they were preparing themselves to complete rebuilding of the temple. I mean, so temple also indicates always the worship of a Christian. So our personal life is a temple. The Bible says that our personal life is a temple, and our family is a temple where the worship is happening. Our personal life is a temple where the worship is happening. And our church is a temple of God. There also there is a worship, which means there should be a worship in our personal life and worship in our family life. And also there should be a worship in our church. Okay, so you have to understand the link of the worship. I mean, when there is a worship, I mean, a worship happening in our personal life, surely in a family, there will be a worship. I mean, where there is a family worship, then that will become the church worship. I mean, so whenever we gather together in the presence of God for worship, we have to understand, I mean, in the church also, I mean, God's presence is coming down and God's presence is blessing us. Hallelujah. And if you want to see that blessing of God, whenever we gather together in the church or whenever we gather together on the Zoom, wherever it may be, I mean, we have to understand the presence of God is there because, I mean, we are coming to the presence of God with a preparation. Hallelujah. Today, what is happening? Most of the people are coming and joining in the Zoom and joining in the worship service without any preparation. Simply, they are coming and joining and singing songs and praying. Just let me tell you one thing, brothers and sisters and children, take a few more minutes in the presence of God. Come in time, join in time, and take a few minutes in presence of God. Prepare yourself and start to pray, start to bless the name of the Lord, start to worship, start to listen to the word of God. The Spirit of the Lord will, I mean, speak to you personally. Hallelujah. So we need the preparation to before the worship. Hallelujah. You know, some people think church building is the only place where we are able to worship God. Church place or the church building, the Zoom platform is the only place where we are able to worship God. But in the as per the New Testament doctrine or concept, you know, we understand each believer is the temple of God. That's what we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 16. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? Hallelujah. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and God's Spirit dwells in you? This morning, let me ask you, I mean, one more question. I mean, how many of you believe, how many of you are assured that, I mean, you are the temple of God? Hallelujah. So if you are the temple of God, if you believe that your body is the temple of God and in us there is a spirit dwells in us, if you believe that, remember one thing, I mean, whatever you do, whatever you speak, and whatever you think, that should be, I mean, pleasable to God. And before you think and before you speak and before you do something, I mean, remember one thing, I mean, you are the temple of God. Hallelujah. I mean, and try to, I mean, keep yourself, I mean, holy in the presence of God. Then only you will be able to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. That's what we read. We are the temple of God. And again, in John chapter 2, we will read that verse. Yeah, John chapter 2, verses 19 through 21. John chapter 2, verses 19 through 21. Yeah.
Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body.
Okay, so here what happens? Jesus said to the Jewish people that, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." Okay, so they were thinking, oh, he is speaking about the temple of Jerusalem. But Jews then said, it has taken 46 years, right? It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? This is the question from the Jewish people. You know, Jesus said, you just destroy this temple and in 3 days, I will raise it up. And they were asking, hey, it has taken, 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? I mean, but he was speaking about the temple of his body. That means he was saying that, okay, if you destroy me, if you destroy me, I mean, I'm ready that, I mean, this body or this temple will be rebuilded, I mean, in 3 days. That accurately happened during the time of the death of Jesus Christ and burial of Jesus Christ. I mean, Jesus was buried, and Jesus was died and buried, and on the third day, he was resurrected from the death. Hallelujah, from the grave. Amen. So that means, I mean, he was speaking about the temple. His body is the temple of God. So it's important to rebuild the worship of our personal life, family life, and the church, and the worship of our church. Amen. And when we think about the rebuilding of the worship in church, we need to read some of the verses from Ezra chapter 3. Okay, now I'm going to speak about the congregational worship. Okay, we have been speaking about the personal worship life and something. Now we will be speaking about the congregational worship is there. Congregational worship, that means when the people of God gather together, I mean, that is called the congregational worship. Okay, now, I mean, let us see what is the importance of the worship and also what is the importance of the unity among the people of God in every aspect. Amen. What is the importance of the unity, I mean, among the people of God in every aspects. Okay, so that is the emphasis on unity in worship. The emphasis on unity in worship. For that, we will read, I mean, maybe 3 verses first, then we will, I mean, think about all those things later. Ezra chapter 3, verses 1, 9, and 11.
When the 7th month came, the children of Israel were in the towns. The people gathered as one man to Jerusalem. And Jeshua with his sons and his brothers, and Kadmiel and his sons, the sons of Judah, together supervised the workmen in the house of God, along with the sons of Henadad and the Levites, their sons and brothers. And they sang responsively, praising and giving thanks to the Lord. For he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever toward Israel.
Very good. Thank you. So here we read that people gathered together. Okay, so we are speaking about the emphasis or the importance of the unity in worship, the congregational worship. Think about what is the emphasis or what is the importance of the unity in congregational worship when the church come together. Okay, listen, the people gathered together, and again, the workers, I mean, stood together. Then again, the Levites sang together, and all the while the people were working together to get the foundation laid. The tasks were varied, but they all had one goal in their mind, to glorify the Lord by rebuilding his temple. Remember one thing, whenever we gather together, we are not trying to, I mean, glorify ourselves, or you are not trying to glorify your pastor or anybody else, but we are trying to, I mean, glorify the name of the Lord in our congregational worship. Hallelujah. That should be a very important thing, that whenever we gather together in our congregational services, congregational worship, hallelujah, and we are trying to glorify the name of the Lord alone. I mean, not any one of us, I mean, name should be glorified or performed. I mean, but we have to glorify the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. And this same unity is visible in many places in the history of people of Israel. The same unity, okay, in many occasions. For example, David, when he brought back the Ark to Jerusalem, okay, from the house of Obed-Edom, okay, and Solomon, when he dedicated the temple, and the priests and Levites, I mean, sang praises to the Lord, accompanied by the trumpets and the cymbals, and the people responded with a great shout that was heard afar off, hallelujah, and we see the people united their hearts and voices in the praise to the Lord for the goodness of God, hallelujah. So these things are happening in different places, in different occasions of the people of Israel. You know, David and Solomon, all the priests and Levites and all the people, they were gathering together in one accord, and they were praising God without thinking about, I mean, any other things, hallelujah. That there should be a unity in our worship. That's the reason that, I mean, while Paul, Apostle Paul, he was writing to the church at Philippi, and he was saying that, I mean, make my joy complete by being, I mean, like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Hallelujah. What is that? You know, there is a togetherness in worship. There is a togetherness in worship. You know, whenever, I mean, different background people are gathering together, we have to think about one thing. Even though the people are from different or various background, I mean, when they are coming together, when they are worshiping together, hallelujah, and let their mind be one, and let them be in one accord. Let them be in one accord and in one mind. There is the blessing of God. There is the blessing of God. Hallelujah. And when the double-minded people are gathering together, there is no blessing of God. Hallelujah. When the people are, I mean, coming, gathering, I mean, in harmony, and when the people are gathering in unity, there is the blessing of coming upon the people of God. Hallelujah. So that's what we read in Philippians chapter, 2, verse 2. Hallelujah. Now, I mean, when you read Ezra chapter 3, verses, 12 and 13, okay, there's a particular, an important thing we have to understand. Ezra chapter 3, verses 12 and 13. Yeah, we'll read that verse.
But many of the priests and Levites and heads of fathers' houses, old men who had seen the first house, wept with a loud voice when they saw the foundation of this house being laid, though many shouted aloud for joy. So that people could not distinguish the sound of joyful shout from the sound of people's weeping, for the people shouted with great shout, and the sound was heard far away.
Okay, think about these things. You know, I know that it is not easy to remember all those things, but let me try to make it clear. You know, in Ezra chapter 3, verses 12 and 13, we see the togetherness in veracity. Togetherness in veracity, or unity in veracity. Okay, here we see the mixed reaction among the people when the foundation of temple has been laid. The mixed reaction among the people. That means the young men shouted for joy and the old men wept with a loud voice. See, these are the two reactions of the people, those who were gathering together when they were laying the foundation for the temple. What happened? The young men shouted for joy. That means the young people or the new generation, they were shouting and worshiping God. At the same time, the old generation, the old people, they were weeping loudly in the presence of God. Listen, all the men who had seen the first temple wept with a loud voice when the foundation of this temple was laid before their eyes. I mean, the older men knew that his temple would never match up to this glory of this temple. And this combined with the joy of the restoration to make profound mixed, feeling in the old men. Hallelujah. Yet many shouted aloud for joy. That means the younger generation who had no remembrance of their prior temple felt nothing but joy in seeing this important step in the restoration of the temple and its worship. Hallelujah. Remember one thing, you know, the older generation, all the old people, you know, the old people, they have many memories in their life. They have seen the, old temple of Solomon, and they know that, okay, how beautiful it was. And now they are just thinking about all those things and they're just crying. They're just weeping. Oh, it was a wonderful day. And before we were going to the captivity. And now, what happened to us? And this is a pathetic situation in our life. So they were just crying and weeping in the presence of God, the older generation or the old people. But the younger generation, they started to joyfully, sing unto the Lord. And they started to, shout to the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, we have to understand the older generation could not ignore the past. The older generation could not ignore the past. I mean, same time, the younger generation couldn't keep quiet when they remembered the miracle working hand of God. Hallelujah. That means even in our congregation also, acceptance must be one of the important factors in matter of worship. Let me explain that. The acceptance must be one of the important factors in the matter of worship. I know in some Christian churches today, have similar generational disagreements. Similar generational disagreements. That means some people think, this must be the way of worship, and the other group of people think that this is not the, way how we should worship God. You know, there are some people, they believe that, okay, this must be the style of worship, or this must be the, a method of worship, and this is how we are supposed to worship God. And the other group of people will say, no, this is not the style of worship. There are different groups of people in the churches, in everywhere. So the older generation always enjoy singing the traditional hymns with their doctrinal substances, but younger generation of the church want to worship that has more contemporary approach, different kinds of worship system. So there are various concepts about this style of worship. There are different and various conceptions about the style of worship. For example, let me give you the example. You know, some people like to clap their hands in worship. Okay, I'm trying to bring some of the examples. Some people, they like to clap their hands in the worship. At the same time, some people like to lift their hands and praise God. They are lifting their hands and praising God. And some like to sing the song very speedily. And some like to sing very slowly. And some like to speak in tongues when they worship worship the Lord. And some don't like to speak in tongues. Some worship God loudly. Some worship very silently. You know, I have seen many people, crying loudly and weeping in the presence of God. And tears are coming, when they are praying and when they are worshiping. Hallelujah. And at the same time, others are worshiping and they are singing in different manner. You know, they are singing and praising God and they are clapping their hands at the same time. There are some people just simply standing there and crying. Remembering many things in the past. And they were just remembering, what the Lord has done for us. Hallelujah. And so there are different styles of worship systems. And there are different styles of different manner. So this morning, let me tell you one thing, that let us learn how to accept everyone who attend and join in our congregation. Hallelujah. This is very important thing. Just I want to share with you, from the, chapter 3, verses 12 and 13. This morning, know one thing, that let us learn how to accept everyone who attend and join in our congregation, because this is the congregational worship. Hallelujah. We don't have any right to, criticize other people about the style of their worship. Amen. If they fail to weep and if they fail to cry in the presence of God, let them cry. Let them weep. Hallelujah. If they fail to cry, let them cry. If they fail to speak in tongues, let them speak in tongues. Hallelujah. Please don't try to mock others. We have to, think about these things very seriously, because, we know that, the worship is coming from the heart. Hallelujah. And if somebody is doing in other way, if they are clapping hands, let them clap the hands and let them praise the name of the Lord. That should be the style of them. If they're speaking in tongues, they received that experience. Let them speak, no problem. We are not supposed to criticize anyone. Hallelujah. And if you feel that, okay, lift your hands and praise the name of the Lord. And if you feel that, okay, jump from there and praise the name of the Lord. Shout loudly and joyfully. Lifting the presence of God, and that would be good. Hallelujah. You know, there are some preachers, they may preach loudly, but some may preach very slowly. Everyone has the style of preaching. So please don't try to criticize them. That is not our duty. Hallelujah. So let us learn how to admit and accept each person in worship. That we understand from this particular verses that the older people, they were worshiping God at the same time. They were just weeping and they were just remembering the mercy of God. The faithfulness of God, and they were just praising God. Through the tears. Hallelujah. At the same time, the younger generation, they did not know anything about the older temple, but now they understand. Oh, God is miracle. miracle. I mean, miracle God, miracle working God. And now we are worshiping God joyfully, shouting the name of the Lord. I mean, with praises and glory. Hallelujah. Because God has done many things in their life also. Hallelujah. So this is what we have to understand this morning as we are, out of time. Let us all submit us with the mighty hand of God this morning and let us pray together in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Close your eyes in the presence of God this morning. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. As we were listening, from the word of God, that we have to surrender our life in the presence of God. We are approaching to the altar of God. The people of Israel, they were trying to rebuild the temple. Secondly, the first thing they did was, they were trying to rebuild the altar. The second thing they were trying to rebuild the temple of God. The temple of God speaks about or indicates about the worship of a Christian life. Hallelujah. Whenever we gather together, hallelujah, there is a personal worship is there, family worship is there. At the same time, we are the body, we are the temple of God, and there should be a worship in family. At the same time, when we gather together in congregational worship, hallelujah. Remember one thing. Hallelujah. There should be a unity. Hallelujah. Even though we are coming from, different background, maybe from different church background, different family background, no problem. When we gather together, we are not worshiping any human being. We are worshiping God. Hallelujah. Let our mind be, set in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Let our heart be set in the presence of God. And let us worship the Lord in truth and spirit. Hallelujah. We have no, right to criticize anyone, those who are, worshiping God in different, styles. Hallelujah. That's what we read there. And both the old people, the old generation and the new generation, young generation, they were worshiping God and they were crying in the presence of God. They were praising the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Let us have that acceptance. Let us accept everyone. Hallelujah. Let us have that mind in our life. Let us come together in the presence of God in one accord, in one mind. That mind should be glory of the Lord. Let us glorify the name of the Lord. Let us all, give ourselves the mighty hand of God according to the word of God. This morning, I request praise to lead us in prayer now. Praise God.
ഹല്ലേലൂയാ സ്തോത്രം 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 പരിശുദ്ധനും നിത്യനുമായ ഞങ്ങളുടെ ദൈവമേ ഹല്ലേലൂയാ സ്വർഗീയപിതാവേ ഈ അനുഗ്രഹമായ രാവിലെ സമയത്തിനായി നന്ദിയോടെ ഞങ്ങളെ സ്തുതിക്കുന്നു വാഴ്ത്തുന്ന കർത്താവേ അനുഗ്രഹിക്കപ്പെട്ടൊരു ദൈവദിനം കേൾപ്പാൻ തക്കവണ്ണം കർത്താവേ ഹല്ലേലൂയാ ഞങ്ങളുടെ ജീവിതത്തില് കർത്താവിടുന്ന് വീണ്ടും ഞങ്ങളെ സഹായിച്ച് വർദ്ധിപ്പിക്കായി സ്തോത്രം ചെയ്യുന്നു കർത്താവേ ഹല്ലേലൂയാ സ്തോത്ര ഈ സമയം വരെയും കർത്താവേ ഞങ്ങളുടെ സന്നിധി കർത്താവെ പാട്ടുപാടുവാനും ആരാധിപ്പാനും കർത്താവെ അവിടെ ഞങ്ങളെ സഹായിച്ചു കൊടുത്തതിനായി സ്തോത്രം ചെയ്യുന്നു വീണ്ടും കർത്താവെ നല്ല ദൈവവചനം കർത്താവ് കേൾപ്പാന്ത കൊണ്ടും കർത്താവെ ഞങ്ങളുടെ ദാസനെ കർത്താവ് അവിടുന്ന് കരങ്ങൾ എടുത്ത് ഉപയോഗിച്ചനായി നന്ദി പറയുന്നു കർത്താവെ ഞങ്ങൾ കേട്ടതുപോലെ ഞങ്ങളുടെ ക്രിസ്തീയ ജീവിതത്തിൽ കർത്താവെ ആരാധനയ്ക്കുള്ള പ്രാധാന്യം മനസ്സിലാക്കിയ കർത്താവ് ഈ ദിവസങ്ങളിൽ കർത്താവ് അതിപ്രകാരം മുന്നേറുവാൻ തക്കവണ്ണം കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങളെ ഓരോരുത്തരെയും സഭയായ ഭവനങ്ങളായി കർത്താവ് അധികമായിട്ട് കർത്താവോട് ഞങ്ങളെ സഹായിക്കുമാറാകണമേ എന്ന് ഞങ്ങൾ അങ്ങോട്ട് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു കർത്താവെ ഞങ്ങളുടെ ഇടിഞ്ഞു കിടക്കുന്ന യാഗപീഠങ്ങളെ പണിയുവാൻ തക്കവണ്ണം കർത്താവെ അവിടെ ഞങ്ങളെ വീണ്ടും സഹായിക്കുമാറാകണമേ എന്ന് ഞങ്ങൾ അങ്ങോട്ട് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നത് അതാ ഹല്ലേലൂയാ സ്തോത്രം സ്തോത്രം കർത്താവെ അതിൽ കാൽവരി ക്രൂശിൽ അവസാനത്തുള്ളി രക്തം വരെ ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് വേണ്ടി ഊറ്റി തന്ന കർത്താവെ ഹല്ലേലൂയാ അങ്ങയുടെ സ്നേഹത്തിനായി കരുതലിനായി കർത്താവെ നന്ദിയോടെ ഞങ്ങൾ അങ്ങനെ വീണ്ടും സ്തുതിക്കുന്നു കർത്താവെ ഹല്ലേലൂയാ സ്തോത്രം സ്തോത്രം വീണ്ടും കർത്താവെ ഹല്ലേലൂയ ഞങ്ങളുടെ കർത്താവെ ഞങ്ങളെ തന്നെ ഒരുക്കി കൂടെ യാഗമായി സമർപ്പിച്ചുകൊണ്ട് കർത്താവെ ഹല്ലേലൂയാ സ്തോത്രം ഞങ്ങൾ അധികമായ കർത്താവെ ഞങ്ങളുടെ നാമമഹത്വത്തിന് വേണ്ടി പ്രയോജനപ്പെടുവാന്ന് കൊണ്ടും കർത്താവെ ഈ ദിവസങ്ങളിൽ ഞങ്ങളെ കർത്താവിടുന്ന് ഒരുക്കുമാറാകണമേ എന്ന് ഞങ്ങളങ്ങിയോട് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു വ്യക്തിപരമായിട്ട് കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങളെ അതിനായിട്ട് സഹായിക്കണമേ കുടുംബങ്ങളായി കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങളെ അതിനായിട്ട് ഒരുക്കുമാറാകണമേ കർത്താവ് സഭയായിട്ട് വീണ്ടും ഞങ്ങളെ കർത്താവ് അതിനായിട്ട് ഒരുക്കുമാറാകണമേ എന്ന് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു അതാ വലിയവരെയും ചെറുവരും ഒരുപോലെ അനുഗ്രഹിക്കുന്ന ദൈവസ്ഥാനത്തിൽ കർത്താവെ ഞങ്ങളെ തന്നെ വീണ്ടും സമർപ്പിച്ച് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്ന കർത്താവെ ഞങ്ങളെ ദൈവത്തിന്റെ മന്ദിരമെന്ന് കർത്താവെ ഞങ്ങളുടെ ആത്മാവ് ഞങ്ങൾ വസിക്കുന്നതെന്ന് തിരിച്ചറിഞ്ഞുകൊണ്ട് കർത്താവെ ദൈവനാമ മഹത്വത്തിനായിട്ട് ജീവിപ്പാൻ തക്കൊണ്ട് ഞങ്ങളെ വീണ്ടും സഹായിക്കുമാറാകണമേ അതായതിനായിട്ട് കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങളെ ശക്തീകരിക്കുമാറാകണമേ ആ പരിശുദ്ധാത്മാവിന്റെ സാന്നിധ്യം കൊണ്ട് ഞങ്ങളെ നിറയ്ക്കുമാറാകണമേ ഞങ്ങളെങ്കിലോട് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു കർത്താവെ വീണ്ടും ഐക്യതയോടെ സ്നേഹത്തോടെ ദൈവകൃപയോടെ കർത്താവെ ദൈവസ്ഥിന് മുന്നേറുവാൻ തക്കൊണ്ട കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങളെ സഹായിക്കുമാറാകണമേ ഏകഭാവമുള്ളവരായ കർത്താവെ ആത്മാവിൽ ഐക്യതം കൊണ്ട് കർത്താവെ ഹല്ലേലൂയാ സ്തോത്ര പൂർണ്ണ സന്തോഷം പ്രായിപ്പാൻ തക്കൊണ്ട കർത്താവെ അധികം അധികമായിട്ട് കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങളെ ഒരുക്കുമാറാകണമേ എന്ന് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു ഞങ്ങളുടെ കൃപയിൽ ആശ്രയിച്ച് മുന്നേറുവാൻ കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങളെ സഹായിക്കണമേ. യുവജനങ്ങളാൽ വീണ്ടും കർത്താവ് ഹല്ലേലൂയ ഓരോ ദിവസവും കർത്താവ് ജീവിപ്പാന്തെ കൊണ്ട് ഞങ്ങളെ സഹായിക്കുമാറകണമേ എന്ന് പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു. ദാസിനെ കർത്താവ് അവിടുന്ന് വീണ്ടും ശക്തീകരിക്കണമേ, ആത്മാവിൽ ബലപ്പെടുത്തുമാറാകണമേ, ശുശ്രൂഷയിലെ കർത്താവ് അവിടുന്ന് വീണ്ടും മാനിക്കുമാറാകണമേ എന്ന് ഞങ്ങൾ ഇവിടെ പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു. അടീനെ കർത്താവ് ഒരു കൂടെ വിശ്വസാഴ്ച സമർപ്പിക്കുന്നു. കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങൾ എല്ലാവരെയും ഒരുമിച്ച് അനുഗ്രഹിക്കണമേ. തുറന്നുള്ള ശുശ്രൂഷകളുടെ മേലും കർത്താവിന്റെ സാന്നിധ്യ കൃപയും അനുഭവിപ്പാതക്കണം. കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങളെ വീണ്ടും സഹായിക്കുമാറാകണമേ എന്ന് ഞങ്ങൾ ഇവിടെ പ്രാർത്ഥിക്കുന്നു. സമ്പൂർണ്ണമായിരിക്കൂടെ താഴ്ത്തി ഏൽപ്പിക്കുന്നു. കർത്താവ് ഞങ്ങളുടെ പ്രാർത്ഥനകൾ യാതിലും കേട്ടാനായി സ്തോത്രം. യേശു ക്രിസ്തുവിന്റെ നാമത്തിൽ അപേക്ഷിക്കുന്നു. കൃപയോടെ കേൾക്കുമാറാകണമേ.
ആമേൻ. പ്രൈസ് ഗോഡ്. ഹല്ലേലൂയ ഹല്ലേലൂയ. സോ നൗ